I'm Janice Buckman. I am the Diversity and Inclusion Partner here at Butler. Diversity is essential at Butler because it is who we are. We have developed a culture where everyone feels welcome and we embrace varying perspectives, life skills, and backgrounds. One of the most important pieces I can give young women is to establish a relationship with one or more mentors. I also encourage young women to speak up, whether on conference calls or at meetings, and to be confident when they do so. And I also suggest that they be prepared, be professional, and be authentic. I'd like now to introduce other Butler attorneys who are going to share with us the information that they learned about other women in law who forged the path for all of us.
I'm Jessica Screen. I'm a partner at Butler's Dallas office.
And I'm Star Brookins, and I'm an associate in Butler's Tampa office.
In 1870, Esther McQuigg becomes the first woman judge in the country when she is appointed the Justice of Peace in a mining town in Wyoming. During her time on the bench, she endured judgment and criticism from several contemporary news outlets, which focused mainly on her clothes and called McQuigg the terror of all rogues. That's kind of a pretty cool title, the terror of all rogues. But it does make sense that sometimes being a woman in a male-dominated industry, we overcompensate by being aggressive when we're really just trying to get our point across. So I can see how Esther might have been called a terror.
And it also speaks to another point, the fact that she was doing such a great job that they were focusing mainly on her clothes. I mean, it could have been the exact opposite, and it could have led us down an entirely different path where society felt that women aren't capable of being judges.
If you're only focused on my clothes, hey, that's fine. If that's the only criticism you have, I'll take it.
So my fact actually happened 2 years later, and it's related to Charlotte Ray, who was the first African-American woman admitted to a formal bar, which was a huge feat, especially considering the fact that slavery had just been abolished 7 years prior to. And there was some controversy surrounding her because apparently when she applied to law school, she applied with her initials. So she applied as C.E. Ray instead of Charlotte Ray. And so some people are wondering whether or not that was to kind of hide her gender.
I'm glad we don't have to do that anymore. I think it's awesome when people look at me and think they can underestimate me, and then they find out that probably wasn't a wise decision.
Hi, I'm Caitlin Ferry. I'm a senior associate here at the Tampa office.
I'm Sarah Burke. I am a partner in the Tampa office.
I have, I guess, a fun fact for you with a pretty cool quote. In 1870, Ada Kepley was the first woman to earn a formal law degree in the U.S., who graduated with an LLB from Union College of Law in Chicago. Kepley proclaimed, "I earn money like a man, I bear the burdens of community like a man, and I'm robbed as a woman." I think that she would be pretty stoked to see that we've passed the Equal Pay Act and we really have come so far in society. It is still kind of staggering, and I think maybe she would be disappointed to see that women still nowadays only earn 80 cents on the dollar to men, despite the fact that this act has been passed, 50 somewhat odd years ago.
In 1873, Myra Bradwell launched the newspaper, the Chicago Legal News, which became the first legal publication edited by a woman and also became the most widely circulated legal newspaper in the nation. In 1869, Bradwell passed the Illinois bar exam. However, in 1873, the Supreme Court ruled that a state had the right to exclude a married woman from practicing law, denying Bradwell admission to the bar. This is interesting because I think nowadays there's a lot of women who are in the legal field. There's more women now in law school. You know, looking at something like this, someone like this who worked so hard to get so far and then have it taken away, we kind of take that for granted.
My name is Kimberly Ramey. I'm a partner in Butler's Tampa office.
And I am Jamie Cumbino-Vias. I am a senior associate in Butler's Tampa office.
In 1981, Sandra Day O'Connor was appointed by President Ronald Reagan as the first female on the U.S. Supreme Court. A quote that I love from Justice O'Connor is, "The power I exert on the court depends upon the power of my arguments. not on my gender. And I think this quote is inspirational because Justice O'Connor understood and appreciated the fact that she was an icon to women everywhere and that she was a trailblazer. But she wanted to be remembered for her work and her talent, not for the fact that she wore heels.
That's pretty interesting. She was quite a great trailblazer. Another trailblazer in United States history is Nancy Pelosi. In 2007, she became the first female Speaker of the House. She's the only woman to have served as the Speaker and is the highest ranking elected female in U.S. history. She did such a great job that in 2019, she became the Speaker again. In an interview with the Washington Post, she credited her role as a mother to have given her the skills she needed to survive in politics. And she is such an encouragement that you can be both a mom and a professional. She's encouraged more and more women not only to vote in the recent elections, but also to be on the ballot and to run for office.
My name is Suzanne Decopane. I'm an associate here in the Tampa office.
And I'm Amanda Meser. I'm an associate here in the Tampa office too.
One African-American attorney that I found very interesting, she goes by the name of Ludi Lytle. She was the first woman law professor in the entire country. She once said, "I resolve to fathom its depths and penetrate its mysteries and intricacies in hopes of being a benefit to my people." And what she was talking about was the level of ignorance amongst African-Americans and the legal system. One thing that I find that resonates with me regarding that quote is what responsibilities do I have as an African-American attorney? And I think back to when I was a prosecutor and how I was the voice of many, including victims of violent crimes. With regard to my current position at Butler, the responsibility in a big law firm is even greater. The ability to continue to break barriers for young women attorneys is very important to me.
A woman that I have found inspiring through my lifetime, especially through law school and now my professional career, has been Sonia Sotomayor. In 2009, she was nominated as the 111th Supreme Court Justice. She was the first Hispanic and third woman to be nominated. She has served as an inspiration for me because she was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes at the age of 7. I was diagnosed with diabetes at the age of 6.5. Seeing someone that's a female with a disability and the same one that I have in the career gave me the message that I could do whatever I wanted to do. As I've gone through school, faced discrimination, faced adversity, I've always persevered. Sonia Sotomayor is a great example of how one can persevere and succeed, and I mean become a Supreme Court Justice. How much better can you get than that?
Hello, my name is Kathy Moss, and I am a partner with the law firm of Butler, Weimuller, Katz & Craig. And reflecting on my career, I came across a landmark case from 1984, Hish Vaughn versus King & Spalding. In that case, the Supreme Court held that law firms could not discriminate on the basis of sex in promoting lawyers to partnership positions. Obviously, I believe that I found a home with this firm. In 1991, I began as a brand new associate with Butler, having just graduated from Florida State University. I made partner within 6 years. I happened to open the Tallahassee office in December of 97, and that's where I continue today. I have served on the executive committee for the firm for several years or several terms. I greatly appreciate all of the support and encouragement Butler has shown to women, as well as to all of our firm members.